Sí, sadu, sadu, sadu. So, dear Dhamma practitioners, in this spiritual practice, we always have to see ourselves and evaluate ourselves, investigate ourselves, how inside our practice happens. The very reason when you become more closer and when you more into practice, it can bounce back to yourself and it can take you to kind of like a difficulty. So, as you know, when too much light can make us blind, too much cold can make us sick. If you really not aware regarding your own practice, and sometimes our own mind start to create a more egocentric ideas inside us related to the practice. So this is something real happened. That there was a teacher and she gave some questions to her students. And one is that what is more important, sun or the moon? So then there was one student wrote an answer. And this student wrote, the moon is more important. We have to protect the moon. And then when teacher look at the papers and saw this answer and asked from this child, why? Why you came to this answer? So then the student told, because the moon always come and at night and it give us the light at night. And then teach us, how about the sun? No, sun is not important. Why? Because the sun always come daytime. See, that sometimes our spiritual practice and wisdom, even that we claim as a wisdom, also take us to that kind of situation. And you have to be very careful. So when even during the Buddha's time, there is a word called for this, Sankhara Varita Vighaita Manasa. Sankhara Varita Vighaita Manasa means that your spiritual practice, whatever you do, you evaluate. And then you use it as a measurement and compare it with others. And then out of that comparison, you develop your egocentric mind. So as you know, nowadays, everywhere people into meditation and different kind of meditation. And out of that meditation, sometimes people criticize ordinary people. See, that you start to practice meditation, but out of that practice, you start to come to an unnecessary problem. So then you have to be very careful, always to be humble with your practice. Don't compare it with others. So there is a reason for this. If you don't develop the wisdom or the panya, that whatever other necessary qualification that you develop related to the spiritual life can bring a harm. So when it comes to this spiritual development, there are five qualities that you have as spiritual powers you can develop. Shraddha, the conviction, or the faith, or the another one is the virya, the effort, and the sati, mindfulness, and the fourth one, samadhi, tranquility state, and the fifth one, the panya. Those are the most important spiritual qualities that you need to develop. And when you develop these qualities, always the basement, the foundation should be the panya. Without the panya, without the wisdom, if you develop other qualities, it can take you to unnecessary difficulties. So how it can happen? So the panya is kind of like, as you know, during even Buddha's time, there were some people used to come and challenge the Buddha. Maybe if it is another religion or another believing system, if that people come and attack, it is okay. But you may heard during Buddha's time from the community of the Sangha, there were some monks even came and challenged the Buddha. See, that even they live with the Buddha, they didn't have the wisdom, the knowledge to recognize this is the Buddha. That's why they came and challenged the Buddha. So how it happened? It's called Anyana Adakkina. The Adakkina means Dakkina. Dakkina means this is the vision that you carry in you. The way you see through your mind is very important. Because when you have the egocentric mind, what happens? You always see the outside with that egocentric idea. Then you cannot recognize whatever the things as it is. You may misunderstand it. Otherwise, just imagine, during Buddha's time, in the same community of the Sangha and the same people around, how they didn't recognize the Buddha. And why they came against the Buddha. How they challenged the Buddha. Why it happened? Even not the kind of like ordinary monks. And these monks had the conviction, the effort regarding the practice. And they had the very tranquility state. And even that they had the high mental powers. So with that also, they came to challenge the Buddha. So then in day-to-day life, you have to be very careful in this path. It is just practicing spiritual, that doesn't mean you are come to doing something, that doesn't mean it's going to make you fulfill in the journey. So you have to develop the wisdom with that. When there is no wisdom, that at the all four qualities going to be very difficult. And it can harm to you and it can harm to others. So the panya, the wisdom is like this. That it is when you plant a tree or the seed, you know there are the leaves come up out of the seed. And then what happening, by the time there is a new leaves come, then old one disappear, But sometimes when the person don't want the tree to grow higher, what they does? they break from the top part of that tree, they break that leaves. And then what happened from the bottom part, they start to grow. So observe what is happening. When they from the one shoot break or cut, the top of the tree that leaves from the branches even, that tree go out of the shape. That from the bottom, it start to grow in a deeper, and it's kind of like a struggle. Each and every branch and the tree leaves start to fight each other. And as a result of that, it cannot grow. And it may have a lot of tree leaves, a lot of branches, but it always go out of the shape, and it cannot produce that it necessary outcome. Once you cut or the break the top of that tree leaves. So the very science is when that the once the very new leaves come, what happening deeply, there is a chemical release to reduce the power of growing that old tree leaves. And that's why it died. And that will help to grow the tree higher, go higher. So the new tree leaves kind of like wisdom. When you don't have the wisdom, maybe it look like you grow with the conviction, with the effort, with the conviction or the faith, with the mindfulness or with the awareness, tranquility state, even with the high mental powers. You can do the miracles. You know, there are many stories when that high mental powers people, if they get disturbed, and they can do greater harm to the people. See? So then you have to be very careful. If when there is no wisdom, what will happen? That it doesn't mean that you're going to grow in the right way. So how you can develop this thing? The very first thing in the conventional life, remember, when it comes to Shraddha or the conviction. So you have faith to practice meditation. And then just do it yourself. And at the same time, when someone in another faith, whatever they do, never criticize. Because the same faith, maybe you close your eyes and practice meditation 5 minutes. Maybe somebody else believe in something else. And then maybe they also spend 5 minutes every day doing that. So don't come to a point to evaluate yourself. Oh, my practice is better than other person. And appreciate that whatever that person carry the faith, appreciate it. And always that whatever the faith that you have, never use it to challenge someone. That you always have to make more humble with the faith, that whatever the faith that you carry, maybe your friend not going to become like that. Your friend doesn't have that the same the capacity like you to develop the faith. Maybe as example, you know how to bow to a monk or the Buddha statue. Maybe another person don't know how to do that exactly like that way. Maybe wearing a hat, and that person maybe just standing without knee down. Maybe just bow to a monk. Then looking at that person, you cannot think, oh, look, you know, I know how to do this, person don't know how to do that. Never come to that kind of comparison. You go out of the track. You miss the point. That's where that you don't have the wisdom. You just evaluate the person from the outside, what that person did. But if you have the wisdom, you go beyond and you become happy with that person, at least that person did that way. Appreciate that. Maybe you cook very nicely and carefully, clean, beautiful, and you prepare it with the great respect and offer it to the monk. Maybe someone else, that person don't know how to do that. Maybe left over. Maybe they ate half and then remember, oh, there's a monk in the temple and I want to give a little bit. And then after that person ate a little bit, it's left over. And they offer. Then you have to remember. If you see that, don't get disappointed. Be happy. Why? Because at least that person, while eating, that person remembered the monk and stopped eating and at least, you know, able to give a half left over. So like that, you have to be wise to go beyond that, the conventional level of seeing, evaluation, and appreciate. Always, you always go towards the profitable way. You never try to increase your unprofitable thoughts. And the virya and the effort, you can use the effort to challenge each other. Oh, I sit for 1 hour. This person cannot sit for 1 hour. Maybe it make you more kind of like a more egocentric person, like in a retreat place, you know, where if we gather around and practice sometimes. And sometimes people become so proud, oh, I can sit very well. If there is another person cannot sit properly, you know, you're looking at that person. You cannot compare. Oh, this person don't know how to meditate. Maybe someone, you know, go to a retreat place or samya and gather in sangha and practice meditation and then close eyes and then sleeping or head down or stretching or doing something or like that. Then looking at that, oh, look at that person. He don't know how to practice meditation. See? That you compare your effort, that you know how to sit properly, but this person doesn't know how to do that. No. Never going to that way. So if you go that way, remember, you miss the point. So always appreciate that. At least this person doing the best that person can. Because when it comes to enlightenment, you know, that's there's an example for that. Mother and the child. The mother always sacrifices her life for the child, to protect the child. It is even in the human world, even in the animal world, there is, you know, it's a very similar. You have seen mostly like, you can see like monkeys. They never leave their babies. Somehow they try to keep the baby with them. And there are a lot of animals even don't know how they do. And nowadays you can see on YouTube, you know, there are animals sacrificed, the mother sacrificed to protect their babies. And in the human world also, the mother, in any challenge, in any situation, in any danger, she don't care about her. She always take care of the child. But when it come to enlightenment, when a person attain to Nibbana, if the mother going to attain to the Nibbana, that is the only place mother go herself without taking the child. Cannot do that. You cannot attain to enlightenment with the another person, with the partner, with the husband, wife, children. You cannot do that. You have the great compassion, and but you go yourself. So this path also, that's why, just comparing to others, you cannot go this way. Just do yourself and just appreciate whatever that other people can do. Even not only in the Buddhism, that whatever other religion. So whatever the effort they have regarding their faith, you have to appreciate it. Why? Because at least they same like what we believe this is right, that people also practice what they right. They believe it is right. If it is not harmful to anyone, not hurt to anybody, then it is okay. Why? Because when the effort become fulfilled, it always, if it is the right effort, it always going to take to the right path. So then conventional level, surface level, don't fight. Don't lose your path because of other people comparing to them. And the sati, mindfulness. Even in the convention, even in the spiritual world, look at a lot of the meditation masters, gurus, how they criticize each other when there is opportunity. How it is possible? You know, you talk about the mindfulness, and out of your mindfulness, how you can criticize another person's mindfulness? You cannot do that. So whatever the mindfulness that you believe it is as right, if somebody else believes that another practice, that whatever their mindfulness is right, you have to accept it, appreciate, good for them. Don't go to argue with them. And don't compare, oh, no, this is right, that is wrong. No. See, that is what the Buddha taught. Because if you go that with that argument, comparison, you develop egocentric mind. As a result of that, even you cannot see the Buddha. So, and samadhi. Tranquility state. And when you do more high mental powers, when even you can attain to the high mental powers or the dhyana, or the jhana, or the satori, or the kevalya, maybe you attack to another person. It's like in the ninjas, that the ninja always attack to a ninja. They always go fight with the ninjas. You know, the samurais, they always, you know, fight with the good samurai. They don't fight with the just ordinary people. They don't do that. So the same like sometimes samadhi, tranquility state people, once they attain to the tranquility state, there are a lot of, you know, they make comments regarding others. Oh, I am in tranquility state. If you are in tranquility state, prove me. Also, how you can, they go to argument. And there are a lot of people claim they are as arahantas. You know, they attain to the enlightenment and they challenge for others' enlightenment. And telling, I am enlightened. So then prove that monk is not enlightened. This monk is not enlightened. Like that, they challenge for that. No, you have to be humble. Don't be proud about it. You have to be more humble. If anybody said, even because of the wrong thing, even if that person say, I attained to the enlightenment, appreciate that. At least rather than becoming a terrorist, that person saying he's enlightened, it is good. If you criticize that enlightenment, what will happen next day? No, so like that in a very surface level in conventional life, people hold it to ideas. Maybe they don't have deep understanding. So at least when someone hold it to an idea or the concept, or just surface level of practice, appreciate that. It is good. Appreciate. And maybe there is a you know, homeless person, don't have any money. And maybe he go to the street and start to beg from people. Maybe you don't have anything to give. You know, maybe you also poor. But don't blame to that person. Telling, oh, look at that person. He is so healthy, good looking. Why he cannot work? We don't know. Maybe that person doesn't have that wisdom to do that way. That person, but at least, rather than selling drugs, you know, becoming the big businessman and doing, you know, bad things to society, you know, and becoming a chairman in this weapon company and producing, you know, the very chemical pharmaceutical product, this person is so good. Why? Because out of that person, no any harm come to that person or even to other people. But if you criticize that person, how about that person become a thief? Or maybe go and start to sell drugs. It is very easy to earn money. So like that, you have to be so, you know, deeply think, and that become a part of your wisdom. So that is where you're going to appreciate others. And that will help you to see. That is where your vision becomes so sharp, clear, vivid. Otherwise, whatever the light itself you think, it is not should be there. Like that child, how it, you know, gave the answer. Oh, the sun come daytime. So because of that, it is useless. But that child doesn't know. You experience the day because of the sun. And then what happened? You hate for that. So like that. In the society, when it comes to the wisdom, see, in the Buddha's teaching, see how it is so different. And this old hold by the wisdom. That is where, that's why with the Shraddha conviction, you have to have the wisdom. It go with together. When the wisdom is not there, if just only the conviction, then maybe it go wrong way. So that's why it always, the Buddha's teaching related with the wisdom. And in day-to-day life, remember when you practice, always. So whatever the practice you do, keep the wisdom with you. That wisdom should be to uplifting yourself and at the same time appreciating others and accepting others, not criticizing, not dividing, not resisting. If you do that way, what will happen? Maybe as a result of that, even you live with the Buddha's community, even you become blood related, you know, have the blood related connection, relatives to the Buddha. In the history, if you read the Buddha's story, you will see there are some characters, you know. They used to play together from childhood. They used to live together, like Venerable Devadatta, you know, and they used to live in the same temple sometimes. And even the Venerable Devadatta attained to the high mental powers, but still he didn't see who is the Buddha. See, it can happen to you and me. But when it comes to the teachings, there is a sutta called Sakalika Sutta. And the divine being's deity saw this. And how this Buddha's community monks cannot recognize the Buddha. And they came to Buddha and asked, Venerable Sir, why this happened? Why they cannot see you are a Buddha? That is where Buddha told this information. Because when you don't develop the panya or the wisdom with your conviction, with the faith, and with your effort, and with your mindfulness, and with your tranquility state, this is the result. So then yourself in day-to-day life, so whatever things happen, even at a school, you have to teach to your children. Never learn anything to defeat for anybody, challenge for anyone. Then the meaning of learning will disappear. That's where we experience this, the huge mess in the world. Look at how the world behaves. No. So we all again go back to again and again to the same mistakes everywhere. We cannot get out of that. And children learn from childhood more than any other time. And the preschool, kindergarten, then they learn a lot of things. And from the kindergarten to high school, universities, they learn a lot. But look how the world behaves when they become young people, when they become responsible people, what they do. They do more stupid things than our ancestors did. Why? How it is possible? Because we don't develop the wisdom related. We don't keep the relationship with the wisdom. Even we have the faith. More than any other time, people have the faith regarding God or the Buddha or the wisdom or the any other things, whatever they practice, whatever they believe. But still, around the world, we kill each other because of just the faith. And the effort, people have the effort more than any other time. And look at, just go to this 7-Eleven and see how many energy drinks nowadays. You know, people go crazy for energy. But look mentally, how we weak. Where that energy bring the peace, harmony, tranquility state to the society, to the world. Even the birds, even the animals. In danger, unseen these little animals, innocent animals in danger. If there is a beautiful bird, that bird in danger. If there is a beautiful lion, that lion in danger. If there is a beautiful deer, that deer in danger. Even that, not only that, if there is a beautiful flower, you think, what will happen to that flower? People destroy that. If there is a beautiful tree, what will happen? We go and destroy it. So this is where we are. We have to think again, why this happened to us then? Because we disconnect, even though we have the effort, we disconnect from the wisdom. And the sati, mindfulness. You know, that the people, more than any other time today, you will see people talk about mindfulness. And go to the apps, how many mindfulness apps? More than any other time, in the software developments, it has a huge market for mindfulness name. But look how people become crazy. Go to the mental hospitals, ask from a psychiatrist, and mentally people collapse. Not only one person, generation, the whole generation collapse. people become crazy. Why? Because we disconnect from the wisdom. Samadhi. And the more than any other time, you know, people get into certain kind of high mental powers. Because to gain this all the success, we need the mind. And as a result of power of the mind, and there are a lot of people achieve to that. More than any other time, you see the gurus, you know, and more than any other time, you see the enlightened masters, you see the monks and the, everywhere. But they fight each other. They don't respect each other. They don't want to accept anybody as enlightened or at least as a spiritual practitioner. They always argue, telling, no, I am the right. You are wrong. So like that. Why? Because we disconnect from the wisdom. So then remember yourself, teach your children. Never learn anything to defeat anybody. And learn something, teach them to learn something, to give a service and accept with the respect. And even in your workplace, never do any work to defeat somebody. Let down somebody. Never do something like that. Appreciate according to that person. That is the only capacity that person can do. That is the only thing that person can do. So appreciate that. It is enough. Don't push people. So for your level, don't compare each other higher or lower. Just do your best. And always be humble. Never use your any qualities to be proud. That is where you gain the inner wisdom. That is where you gain the inner light. Even when you have that wisdom, you know what happened? Even you no need to see physically the Buddha. Even Buddha is no longer with us. Just Buddha's word, when you hear it, that is enough for you to attain enlightenment. You no need to wait for another Buddha. You no need to wait for another life. Wherever you are, it doesn't matter. You are in, as you live like a beggar or you are a millionaire. You are healthy or you are sick. You are a child or you are an elder. You are a monk or you are a layperson. It doesn't matter. When you have that inner light, just by hearing even the Buddha's word, you're able to gain that. And that is where you're going to transform yourself to your liberation. That is where you're going to experience your ultimate bliss of Nibbana. So with that, I bless upon everyone with this good practice. May all of you be well, happy and peaceful. May no harm come to you. May no difficulties come to you. May no problems come to you. May you also have the patience, courage, understanding and determination to meet and overcome inevitable difficulties in your life. During this time period, may everyone stay healthy and safe. And finally, may all of you attain supreme bliss of Nibbana. Sabbityo vajjantu sabbarugo vinasatu mate bhavatantara yosuki diga yukubhava ittavata cha mihi sampadam punya sampadam sabbe devanumodantu sabba sampatti siddhya sabbe bhutanumodantu sabba sampatti siddhya sabbe sattanumodantu sabba sampatti siddhya idamme punya kammang asavakkaya vaham hotu sabba dukkha panum chatu. Bless you.